make a motion, we accept the minutes of the February 1st meeting.
Second?
Sorry.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, number two on our list, discuss the town hall funding project, and we have just the guy we need in the room tonight.
Hi, Paul.
How you doing? Oh, he's Fred. Thanks for coming in.
Sure.
Okay. Last week, we had a discussion, again, regarding the funding of the town hall community center. And obviously, a big chunk of that funding is coming through CPA.
Yes.
And given that you're the individual in town who oversees, monitors that chunk of money, we really would like to know how this is going to unfold.
Okay.
Okay, and do you see any ramifications from it that we haven't seen or we haven't spoken about? Or, so, you know, I'm sure we all have a couple of questions, but why don't we hear from you how you see this whole thing rolling out as we approach it? Okay.
Take a look. I think you guys all got this sheet here.
Yeah.
All right. This is based on a $1.2 million project. That's the numbers that we were given. I see there's new numbers tonight.
Yes.
It could be a 1.4 or 1.374.
Yeah, we'll get it out to you today after.
All right. We were told, when I say we, I'm talking about CPC, the Human Preservation Committee, okay? We were told that...
Alan, just, is there any difference between CPC and the CPA?
CPA is the act.
Okay.
It's the bylaw.
That's the law.
CPC is a Community Preservation Committee.
Committee, got it. Okay.
Thanks. We were told that the town may be coming up with $315,000 in capital funds towards this project. Last night, we met, we voted to allocate $340,000 of CPA money from the unbudgeted reserve fund, which stands right now at $346,000. But as of July 1st, we should be getting in another $150,000 for the next fiscal year. We feel comfortable with the $340,000 to apply towards the town hall project. We think there's going to be private donations of around $150,000. I believe there are about $100,000 right now, and they plan to do some more canvassing of the town and get more donations. So that brings it up to $800,000. On a $1.2 million project for $400,000 short. The second vote the CPA or CPC took last night was to borrow up to $400,000 using CPC funds or the promise of the surcharge that we have in the town for 20 years. Which brings us to the second sheet that you have in front of you. What 20 years looks like borrowing $400,000. And the CPC felt comfortable that they could pay that debt service and still have money for other projects that come before the CPC. One of the biggest or longest discussions is where is that breaking point of, okay, let's empty, or almost empty our coffers to support this town hall project.
Right.
Knowing there's still APRs gonna be coming, there's still people who are doing the cemetery restoration work.
Mm-hmm.
There's a bunch of projects that we can't even think of that may be coming. But based on history, we've been at this for 8 years now, we're comfortable with these numbers here.
Okay. Any questions, Alan?
Yeah, I was at the meeting yesterday and I was appreciating what this CPC has been doing for the town hall and for funding and supporting it. We had a meeting of the building committee 4 o'clock today, as well as 99% final, and cost estimate, and I gave you a sheet, which you're all happy to hear, the breakdown of the cost estimate. Yeah, we started with the $1.2 million back in November. That's what the best guess was. We made a lot of revisions, ups and downs on some of the items here. It's still $1.2 million, kind of the basic one, but we've got some alternatives to add here for doing some site work, which is the parking in the front of the building, which doesn't have to be done when the building itself is done. And also the septic. We're not completely sure yet about the septic. So if you add them two items in here, like I had on the note, it coincidentally comes up with the 1.37. Funds that are available. So
yeah.
I guess my point in showing you that is that we still need the 1.37 funds committed for the project, not the 1.2. We're not saying now that we can reduce any of these either the town funds or even CPA. Of course, the big question is still the grants. We only applied for the cultural facilities grant so far. That application went in. Go and know, Joe, it's June sometime about that. We're working on the green communities right now. That may go up a little higher than 175, but that is not going in yet. And then the mass preservation grant will go in next month. So, but we won't know until June, or July 1st, the status of that, how much we get. So, so if everything falls in place, we get all the grants, we'll be sitting pretty happy here, I guess, with the funding we have, without borrowing.
Yeah, I was going to say, if we get any of the grants, will reduce the amount that CPC is going to pay every year.
Right.
I would like to add, if we do have to borrow, I would encourage the treasurer, I believe that's who does the borrowing, to find a loan where it can be paid back in a shorter amount of time. CPC may have funds available in 5 years because there's no project coming before us to be able to pay down this loan.
Yeah.
So keep that in mind. I say that out loud so everybody's thinking right about it when we do go out for a loan, if we do.
You're not drawing down entire CPC or CPA funds?
No, sir.
Okay, so there's still, and how do individuals in town understand that, so that what we want to avoid is someone coming to the polls voting against this thing because they think the CPA money, this is going to, you know, suck all the CPA money out of the room.
And well, every year at town meeting, we give a budget. We show how much is in each bucket and how much is in the unbudgeted reserves. Mm-hmm. We'll do the same thing this year. And we're going to have something in the scoop or something in the newspaper to explain it further if we need to. But it'll show that we can't use money that's budgeted for open space, and we can't use money that's budgeted for
elderly housing or whatever.
Yeah, something like housing.
Housing. There's, right. What, four
there's
things?
Three. Housing, and then the other one is historic preservation, which we're talking about here.
Okay.
That money we can't use.
You can't, you're not going to touch that?
No.
One thing that we're thinking of doing, and I guess I'm free to talk about open meeting even though I haven't talked to Brian or anybody else, is have an information session on at least the town hall project. And we thought about it, and what are we going to present? Well, the only thing that's really changed is the funding. That you're seeing here in front of you is the funding sources, what we're trying to achieve. And thinking for a minute about an information session like we had in November to maybe focus on financing the town hall. CPC can talk about financing, what you have available, what it used for, past history, and all that kind of stuff. Finance board wants to present something about budgeting or the budget or whatever else, we can do that. We've also got the water department that's working on something, merging the two, that we can have another information session before annual town meeting. That's what we're thinking about. I'm not looking for an answer today, just think about it, we can talk with the select board and Brian, whether we want to pursue that, but just for your information.
Is there anything coming, is there any chance that any of the CPA money does not come through?
Not what we're talking about right now, no, sir.
Okay.
You got it in, this $340,000 you got in hand.
It's in the bank.
But it's not assured what'll happen in the future, in terms of us getting the 3% or whatever we've been lucky to get.
It doesn't matter.
No, not for this.
Not for this.
But I'm just saying.
Well, it may come around, we may have to say no to an APR, we may have to say no to restoring some cemetery stones, because there's no funds available, because we spent it on this, assuming, and we don't get the state grant, and we're always going to get the $75,000 a year from the local surcharge.
Right.
Unless we vote that down, but the thing is, if we do borrow, we cannot get rid of, as a town, we cannot get rid of CPA. We can reduce the rate, if it's $28,000 of debt service for 20 years.
You could be reduced down.
We can reduce it down to 1% instead of 3%, if that comes out to $28,000. But we have to have CPA ongoing to cover that debt service.
I think what may sell CPA funds on this is, this is probably the first major project where you could say you're using a good chunk of CPA money. You know, we've had other projects, but it's here and there and all over, and it doesn't really benefit the whole community. There you can say, well, here's a building that we're funding with a large amount of money that's gonna benefit everybody in town. It's for your benefit, not just an APR for this area or for this project or whatever, it's for the whole town. And I think it shows them we're finally doing something, you know, if we're constructive or maybe useful or visible with CPA money.
Yeah, just caution, when we say, vote to save a piece of land as open space, I think that benefits the whole town too.
Right, but this is something.
I understand it's a building that you.
More visible and.
Or you can look at Mount Sugar without buildings in your way, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
I don't mean to degrade other funding, other project funded, but.
Seeing how you are one of the larger landowners in town, and you probably talk with other individuals who farm their land, who have, you know, a sizable number of acres, what's your gut feeling about support for this project amongst those individuals?
I think it's fine.
You think it's a go?
I haven't heard anything against it, no, sir. And when you get to the poles behind that curtain, anything can happen.
Well, that's, I have.
Oh, sure.
I have a question for Len.
No question.
This won't go to the poles.
This is gonna, that's my question, it's gonna, at town meeting, we will vote this, if everything is in order. Does it have to go to a ballot or not?
Not until we actually.
Only if you're, I mean, if you're going to be using CPA funds to pay for it all, you wouldn't have to go to the poles. But if you do have to borrow above and beyond what we can absorb in the tax levy, then you would end up having to go. But in this case, I don't think you would, the proposed funding sources right now, you wouldn't have.
Right, so, but really, we won't be 100% sure of whether we're gonna have to borrow or not until we see what happens with these three grants.
You're gonna have to borrow, but you don't have to go to the polls to borrow, you have to have the two-thirds vote at town meeting.
Okay.
Because you gotta have the upfront money, and you won't have it all in hand, because you're borrowing in anticipation of CPA funds to pay off the debt service.
All right.
But there is a shortfall, I believe, of $174,000. Because we're, this, the colors chart is based on 1.2 million.
And now it's 1.3.
$374,000.
$374,000.
Yeah.
So we're still short.
So if we get $200,000 in grants, we're fine.
That's assuming we need.
Right, yeah.
Just to change gears slightly, Fred. To take a page from Deerfield's recent roofing job that they had on the school, I'm sure we all read in the paper how because an individual stayed on top of the individuals, the company that was actually doing the work and made sure they came in on time, sort of like a clerk of the works kind of an individual. Does anybody, do you foresee us having that kind of person donate some time to make sure, if this project gets off, because this is another strong point, I think, with individuals that are going to be voting, as to whether or not we can control the end number of this project. Because, I mean, right now it's 1.37, and it's come up a little bit since the last time. It can't keep going up.
That's the maximum, but we, just to reserve funding, I guess, if I was to say today, whether we go that high or not, probably not. And then it's going to depend on the bids you get, too. There is, in this total package, it's for the contractor, superintendent, and project manager to do it for this 30-week time period we're planning this project. So that's what, seven months to do the project. We're thinking maybe starting in fall and to be done by April, early spring. But you know, there is also the thought of hiring, I guess it would be Jones Whitsett Architects to manage all of this for us. We haven't talked about a fee, but I don't know. The figure $25,000 came about. I don't know if that's reasonable or not, but to manage the contract for us, per se. We haven't really discussed that in detail and whether that's a good figure or whether we want Brian sitting there every day to watch and see what's going on, or somebody volunteers in town to do that. We got a contractor sitting here that go by every day. We could ask them, I guess, but
we certainly
got to that point. But I think that is critical. Yeah, we're going to need somebody to monitor what's
to
going
oversee
on.
This, to make sure certain points on the calendar are met.
Yeah.
As time goes on.
Right.
And hold their feet to the fire based on what they said they would do contractually.
Right.
There has to be a point person.
Yeah, there will be. Yeah, we haven't got that far yet.
I seem to recall there's almost a statutory requirement to have a point person responsible for making sure the budget, the work is done on time.
I think that you mean like a clerk of the works kind of person. I think that was at a $1.5 million project or more.
All right. Well,
that's okay.
I mean, where?
Project.
Keep it under.
Yeah. Keep it local.
Okay.
Any further questions for Alan concerning CPA, CPC, the funding, the borrowing? All of the above. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. Next on the list, we just received, let's talk about the library a little bit. We just received a printout. And I know the library is here. Do you want to speak to this? Do you want to just kind of give us an overview of you know what's going on and what you see as important coming up? And I guess you know where your increases are and any new initiatives that are going to be coming.
Well, I've been at the library as the new director for about 2 months, so I'm still getting to know the library community, but I'm really lucky to have a solid group of trustees, as you can see represented here. And from what I can see from the numbers, the long-range plan that just
ended in 2016, a lot of work was done to the building to make it more efficient, with new windows and a new heating air conditioning system that not only makes the building more comfortable for patrons and better atmosphere for materials, but has cut costs dramatically. So that's really impressive to me, because I know it's a much loved, older historical building, but now it's also an efficient older historical building, which I think is great. As far as the numbers of circulating items, people coming in for borrowing, coming to programs, I'm really impressed for a small rural library what the numbers are for that. And I feel like the library has done a really good job in the past for getting materials that really serve the community, having programs that the community wants. And so I feel like as far as any changes financially, the only real change is the trustees decided to add $1,000 for professional development, because I feel like in the last 3 or 4 years, the library has been working hard to get up to a certain standard of being a modern library and becoming part of CWMRs, where the interlibrary loan system has brought a lot more people into our library, circulating a lot more materials, has increased and made our collection more sophisticated. And so with that, they thought professional development for the staff would only benefit the library and the community, because we get to go out there and get exposure to resources, to connections, so that we can just keep providing better services. So nothing really is changing that much. The only thing that that changes dramatically, but it's a requirement of us getting state aid, is the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. They require that you spend 20% of your budget, and that every year that budget increases by 2%. So we're beholden to that, to those numbers. And so, that number does go up every year. The CWMR's network fee doesn't go up that much, but it does go up a little bit every year. Like I said, the numbers went down for fuel electricity, which is great, and also just makes it a better building. That's what I can speak to as far as numbers. Any other questions?
Could you speak to the books figure? I see $10,000 as the FY17 request and $12,945 in 18. Could you just speak to that, please?
When your budget goes up, you have to. When your overall budget goes up, you have to increase that by 2%.
Percentage of the overall.
Yep.
Thank you.
I guess this is more for the trustees. We see where the salary for our librarian is. I'm sure that's there to keep pace with the general market for those individuals. How do you think that is now? Generally, that salary versus salaries in other towns our size, and are we there? Are we at a sweet spot where we can, hopefully hang on to good people?
I think we were waiting to hear the latest study done on that. Has that come in?
That is going to be discussed. But I wanted to add this.
I think this is important. Those studies, it seems to me, are relevant for jobs, if you will, things that have standard sorts of duties and so forth. But I would argue that our director needs to be something a little different than that. We were really looking for someone who had creativity, some vision, someone who could lead us in some new directions and make new uses of the library. And that kind of creative talent, it seems to me, is not the same as a jobs with a set of duties, although she does have a set of duties, obviously. You know what I mean? So
I mean, my position on the trustees was, we need to have, we need to be able to attract and hold people like that. Not just technicians who can do the job and meet the daily requirements of keeping the library going, but someone with some vision and someone who can lead us. And so I was interested in getting us at the upper end of the scale, maybe not worrying about it so much, but to make sure we got the person that we need and want. And I think we've been pretty good.
Sounds like she knows what's going on after 2 months.
I agree with the vision. I mean, every department.
She's not just a librarian.
Vision's critical.
Absolutely. It'd be nice if we had that in the schools as well.
How many hours do each of these positions work? Librarian, a library assistant?
I work 22 hours, and the assistant works 14.
Do you have a sense of the foot traffic that's in and out of the library on a weekly, monthly basis?
Well, I imagine it changes seasonally, you know, depending on the weather and depending on when kids are in the school. Then since I came in right before the holidays, it's kind of a funky time. But it seems like it's pretty steady. I know Saturday's our busiest day, and a lot of people seem to drop by after work. But it seems like the hours that we have now work well for across the range of the demographic of Whately, because we have people that don't work that need to come earlier in the day. We have kids that come right after school, and they have people that come after work, and then people that come on Saturdays.
I wonder if there's a way to better monitor that. And the reason I say that, I know that when we created the Senior Center Board of Oversight 8 years ago now or whatever, no one had any idea what the usage was of that center. And we instituted a real plan to develop that metric and to know, because I think departments are well served to have quote unquote a war room. And to be able to defend why they exist and why the budget exists and how many people they're touching on a daily basis and the value add that the library or whatever brings to the town. So
sure.
I wonder whether there's some mechanism to be able to track that, so you can go to town meeting floor and say, look, we're a 1,500 person town and 500 people, I don't know what the number is.
Well, if you look at the numbers on the statistics.
On the first page, some of them.
It doesn't say exactly how many people come into the library, but it does say people that, items that circulate, for every item that circulates, someone has to come in and pick it up or drop it off. So that's at least a visit to the circulation desk or the drop box. And then people attending programs, I do have a count for that. And I think that this year, this fiscal year, I think a new initiative that's going statewide with the libraries is to do people counting. So we do have, and some people choose to get this little device that you put next to in the door frame. So every time someone walks by, it counts you. We don't have that device, but we have a little, like a matrix at the front desk that we tick off every time someone comes in, makes a copy, uses the computer, whatever. So we are doing a manual count to the best of our ability. So hopefully next year we'll get a number on for that.
Yeah, just a cool number.
Oh, sure. Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely.
I'm curious about the use of the library, though. Is it primarily to borrow books?
That's a great question. It's my favorite question. Because I feel like that once upon a time that was the primary. That's right. Why libraries were built. And now we've evolved to an age where books aren't the only way to get information. So actually, libraries are now not just for books. It's more for, one, information and knowledge, and two, for community. And so we're able to provide guidance for people who want digital assistance on computers or with their own devices. We're able to provide guidance through books, whether it's a good story in a fiction or reference for nonfiction. We're able to provide programs, especially if this library is so wonderful that it's a small library, but it has an amazing community room and an amazing outdoor space that we can provide programs that are educational, entertaining, creative. And my vision going forward is to also expand the library as a community center that may work in tandem with a potential new community center in the Old Town Hall, of having a space that Whately residents or users of the library can come, and it could be a place to go and use your laptop, sit and read, have a conversation with a friend. So it's not just coming and going, you know, you stay a while. So it served all these purposes of gathering, of community, of education, of literacy.
Right. I know the Smith College is redoing their library.
Yes.
And there are a lot of people that are excited about it in all sorts of ways, positive and negative. Mm-hmm. They're getting rid of a lot of books. And in their place, they're having cafes mm-hmm. and sort of social things like that. And maybe it'd be possible to have, I don't know, if we get rid of some of the books or move them somewhere or whatever, if we don't need all those shelves and stacks, we could create, like you're saying, a social space where people could read the paper or, you know, the printed paper as well as the digital paper. I know it's expensive to have digital subscriptions to papers. And I also think maybe an idea would be, and you touched on it, would be to have, and I don't know if it's in librarian training now, but I'm sure it is, to have an information expert. So one of the problems I see as a teacher is there's too much information. And the problem is just how do you get good information out of all the information that's out there? I mean, like I was looking at YouTube the other day, and they had a filter. So I wanted to hear something, and I clicked on, well, how many people listen to this? That's one measure, but that's not necessarily the best measure.
Right.
And they had some sort of rating system, mm-hmm. and I didn't agree with that either. But it would be helpful if you know, somebody wanted, you know, to ask the librarian, well, how's the most efficient way to figure out how to evaluate what kind of contractor I want for my work at my house or get a new car, you know, consumer reports kind of stuff.
Right, right. Well, the good thing about, and this is where professional development ties in, is that there, I don't know if it's like this nationwide, but we have a state that's really, really has a lot of great support and resources for library staff. And one of them is the Master's of Library System, and their main office is in Amherst. And they offer free workshops throughout the year, throughout the state, and they touch on all topics. And one of them is about how to exactly that, how to guide people with information, especially in the digital age. They're just so, you can get off the beaten path so easily, get wrong information. So twofold is that you want to be able to help guide people how to get information and also how to get correct information.
Right.
And there are workshops coming up, especially in the light of this whole thing that's coming about with, you know, fake news.
Right.
To go to good news
sources. Just a quick aside, if I may, we have a vacancy on the trustee board, if you would want to consider that. Right?
Yes.
Thank you. Consider it considered.
I think you'd do well. Probably not. A natural.
So also did you.
Paul, we switch gears slightly. The library has rescinded their capital.
That was my next question. So?
That's still true?
Still true.
Excuse me?
The capital request has been rescinded?
Yes.
Okay.
The kitchen is off?
For now, yes.
Okay.
It's been on our radar for several years, and we accomplished a lot of the infrastructure upgrades, as Candace just mentioned. And we had to take a look at it. And we looked at it, and we presented it, and then we digested it, and the benefit really wasn't there. So I've asked that we rescind that.
Now you can buy that espresso machine.
No breakfasts at the library for the foreseeable future.
Go to the center school.
Okay, just as an FYI, in years past, We would review and discuss everybody's budget here and now, as we just did. And then we would, in many cases, vote on it. And what we decided to do this year is wait on all these budgets till as close as we can get to town meeting, and then have a look at exactly what our financial picture is and how that relates to the budget items that are being requested.
Okay.
And then at that point, do we have to go back and ask people to trim or not?
Okay.
So that's kind of how we're going to approach it for this year.
Okay.
to see how that works. But thank you very much for coming in. Looks good, and the library is an important piece of this town.
Good to hear. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Okay, next is general government. Okay. Is there anyone to speak to general government?
Lynn's going to do it all. No. Myself and Lynn, I believe.
Okay.
Cynthia?
Oh, yes. And Cynthia.
So do you want to give us a sketch of maybe what's new or what's...
Want to send Cynthia go first so that she can have home?
That would be great. Who knows what's happening up in Colerain? I don't know. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. Nothing has changed a great deal. When I put it together, I wanted to make sure that we, for example, had money set aside for education because I think we're going to be looking for a new assessor. And they do have to go to school 1 week. And that costs about $350. Let me see, I haven't really looked at this too. I tried to keep it as close to what it had been so as not to rock the boat. However, just since yesterday, my duplex printer has been acting up. So I have a feeling a new duplex printer is in the works. That is, I have set aside for printer repair $200. I don't believe that would cover the cost of a duplex printer that can handle the Patriot system. I wasn't able to contact Patriot and get an answer today on what that might run, but I think it could be as much as maybe $500 or $600. I don't know, do you have any questions?
Well, it doesn't look like there's been any significant increases.
No.
The significant decrease is because of last year was a revaluation year.
Oh, right. Yeah, that is something, yes. Every 3 years up until now, there's always been a much larger reval budget. That now will become every 5 years, so it won't happen again until FY22. That's when we have Mayflower Valuation do quite a bit of work with us. I always do call in our consultant just before tax rate setting time just to make sure that we can get through all of the, we can dot all the I's and cross all the T's that the DOR wants us to do. But I generally only use them for one day on the non-reval years. So it was high this year, it won't be as high for the next four.
Brian, is there anything that we should be particularly concerned with?
Not for this one.
I don't think so. No. I think you're right.
Not for any of these, I mean.
Is this includes that email and website email also?
I'm sorry, what was the question?
The website email hosting. How can email hosting do skyrocket?
That's not me.
Where do you see that?
Well, that's going to be
it's,
on,
it's not in the assessor's.
It's not assessor's, it's a different
service.
You want to cover that out, or you want to...
Sure.
Are we all set with...
We're all set with Cynthia, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wouldn't it be easier to walk through this in order of the header items?
This is the page before the insurance. Next to last before insurance.
Oh, the heck's insurance?
Now you're gonna have to thumb through it.
I'm sorry, are you mailing?
I'm starting with Selectboard administration.
You wanna go like, you wanna start from the top?
Yeah, let's just start from the top.
Start from the top.
Start from the top.
The high level, not, we're not gonna line on.
No.
No, I'm supposed to be here all night.
We're not Deerfield.
I mean, we may be young, but we're not that young.
I'm gonna get snowed in, I gotta go to bed.
Do you want, I'll do my pieces, Lynn, and I'm gonna let you film your pieces.
We can just go in order and then we have our budgets, we can jump in.
Okay. Selectboard administration, you see there's an overall decrease of $5,000, but a lot of that is moving items. What I tried to do is put all of the computer IT stuff in the same category. It's spread across a couple of different departments, and I wanted to get it together. The other thing you'll see here is there's a line item for an annual audit for USDA. I believe that was required for the borrowing for this building. So there's a decrease of $3,000. Something that we'll talk about a little bit later is probably the need for an annual financial audit for the town. The town has some lending on the horizon, and a lot of the lenders are asking for annual audits. So a lot of some of these items have been moved to the computer IT budget, which was formerly the computer repair budget. A couple of them have moved to the website, you know, hosting, which we'll talk about.
So you broke it up.
Which we'll talk about when we get down there. Other than that, it's.
My only question, I've never noticed this line before. $400 for Memorial Day band.
I had the same question.
Is that we give a donation to?
I have some insight on that one. The band, it used to be that Frontier would bring the band here for a little cost, or the Grange, I think, paid us like $100 to the band, to Frontier, for the bus drivers. For the three buses or whatever that it takes to get the band here to the Memorial Day parade.
They don't get themselves?
They come by bus.
Come on the bus.
More efficient.
So they upped that cost to $400 and the Grange could no longer handle it. So that's what the $400 is. And I think it was brought to you, I don't know, it was after me, so I think it was brought to you guys to pay it 1 year, so I think it ended up in the budget after that.
Yeah, I don't recall, maybe that's true, but.
It's when it slid Delia, in under the radar.
I think Adelia had talked to the board at one point about paying for that, so it ended up.
It's on the table. So
it costs us $400 to have the band at the Memorial Day parade.
Well, basically. It looks like it was $225 that was expended, so exactly. I don't know.
And all, you know, anyway.
Anyway. Is this part of Watermelon Wednesday?
No.
Oh, I'm just checking.
Can't get the bands in.
Mileage and meetings has gone from FY15 of $1,000 to $2,500 request, which is percentage wise is a kick.
Yeah.
Where are we going?
Going to a lot of meetings. Going to a lot of meetings. The biggest thing is the MMA conference in Boston.
So it's the entry fee for that meeting.
Registration and hotel.
Hotel. At the Westin.
Not motel. You didn't hear
hotel.
Motel.
The RITS is okay, right?
Yeah. As long as it's in the state, that's all that matters. Okay. And Selectman 5216, is that all three together, or is that in, is that 5,000 per selectman?
No, that's my new salary.
That's what?
My new salary.
It's like, isn't it, what, 12 and 12 and 15 or something?
I think it's probably like 13, 13 and 16.
Deerfield's five apiece.
Deerfield's five apiece?
They got one.
A little more, no.
We gotta take this up with personnel.
It's coming up.
Yeah, I know.
You know anybody on that committee?
Yeah, I do.
All right.
Good luck.
I might leave and go to Deerfield.
Probably build your building. Yeah. Okay, legal, go.
Legal counsel, that's increased to $300. We don't have the need for attorney for cable contract, because that was signed this year, this past year. There are a lot of legal issues that are still pending that could come up. Contract review.
Who was town council now?
It is Copman Page. Or KP Law now, I think they're called.
Is, how close to, what's the plan versus actual on that?
The most recent we have is FY16, and that was, is that what you're asking?
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see, yeah, okay.
It was 23,000.
And we've had to have recourse to legal counsel more, I think, in the recent past.
Yeah.
Is all legal counsel charged to this activity, or if the individual department has something?
I have a tax attorney for tax state.
I would say, like, we did the housing trust and...
So, for instance, yeah, the setting up the housing trust was something attorney did. If we end up buying or taking the Egypt Road parcel, it's gonna require an attorney. Any sort of lawsuits. We have a water merger that we're gonna have to talk to council about. We're not only merging the two systems, we're trying to merge two entities, and that's gonna require us to consider, taking on our assets as well.
Employee issues.
Well, resources issues, employee board, zoning board, sometimes questions come up.
What's the decision-making process for, I want to get council's opinion. Do they go through you?
Yes.
All everything. No one can hire council except you, or you need your approval.
They should not be hired council. I mean, when does the tax
take?
But that's, we can't do anything about that. I mean, it's sort of the optional thing sometimes.
That's a different attorney?
Yeah.
Okay. So if the planning board has a question, legal question, well,
they go to you first.
Yeah, probably. They go to you first. All right.
Okay.
And then bond council, because there's a likelihood that we have to borrow for the town hall, then probably just.
Good.
You want to cover town office supplies? $2,750. Those were all consolidated last year.
We'll take your word for it. Yeah.
Audit.
Yep, there it is.
We don't have a request yet. I'm waiting for a message back from Scanlon Associates for a ballpark figure as to what an annual municipal audit would be. What happens every year?
Another reason that triggers the audit is the OPEB Trust Fund. They part of Municipal Modernization Act is now requiring an audit every year of the OPEB funds.
Oh, when you say OPEB funds?
The other post-employment benefit package, where we put the $25,000 a year into OPEB for future retirements.
Unfunded liability or whatever
it's an unfunded liability.
Well, yeah, it's...
For health insurance and things like that in the future.
So I'm thinking of that.
Yeah.
That report,
well, that's going to go up. 55 is not going to cover that.
Yeah. And if you remember, there's also, last year there was also $3,000 budgeted that was in the Selectboard budget that USDA analyzed. So last year there was actually $8,500 budgeted, $3,000 in one account, $5,500 in different accounts. I don't know if it's going to be more or less than that, but we'll find out. Town reports, stays at 500. Town building operations. Talk about this a little bit, just the easy stuff. There's a computer repair IT line item of $1,000, that was moved to the other category, to the other budget line item. And miscellaneous website newspaper, that's $700. That's deleted because the newspaper gets paid from Selectboard account, so that's money that we didn't need. I want to touch on the natural gas and the electricity.
What does this pertain to?
This building.
Why do you have propane and natural gas here?
This building?
Yeah.
The town hall and the center school.
Okay, so there's not just one building.
Right.
Okay.
But so I want to talk about the natural gas for a minute. You see the expended in FY16.
Yeah. Yeah.
Versus the amount.
Right.
I also did it, but we had the building for, what do we have, 3/4 of a year for FY16, this building. So while I think this is high, I think the last two winters that we have had are mild. I would feel more comfortable reducing this after we have a cold winter and to see what it comes at. But if there are items that the rubber hits the road and we need to reduce some items, I think that could maybe be able to.
That could take a hit.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, the electricity, the fuel and natural gas and the electricity are the big ones for this building because the electricity runs. Runs the AC units and it runs the heating units. So.
With it partitioned off over there now, should that reduce the heat? We're not heating that basically half of this building.
Right. So that's kept at around 50 degrees because of the wet sprinkler system.
Yeah. We want to make sure that we don't have rosy economic forecasts like this though, because we don't want to get caught with our pants down.
Right.
Sure. So this building uses natural gas. The propane would be.
Propane's at the town hall.
Town hall, okay. And the other buildings are within the budgets of Keith.
Yeah, right now the historical society
police.
Is paying utilities at the center school.
Okay.
Everybody else is heat, electricity, everybody else is budget.
Right.
Yeah. You keep in mind that they increase once we finish remodeling the office spaces here, right? Front of the windows, you could increase your heat and electricity. That's in this year, money is in there for this year's budget, right?
We're heating that now.
To do that, we're not using much electricity.
That back space right now is heated.
Right, but not electricity.
The office space is
heated. Yeah, electricity, I don't know.
Yeah, the lights are off, yeah. For the most part.
It'll be important to know that when we grow up from a technological perspective, that will increase electricity. And we're going to grow up, so.
I hope so.
You know, have access to network here, and so yeah, it's just going to cost us.
I'll be quiet.
Oh, it's me.
Town clerk.
Okay, it's a non-election year, and normally my budget will go down in a non-election year, or I have held off on something that I might need or want in the future, you know, to put it in a non-election year, and that's what I've done this year. Most of the budget is pretty average. My election budget went down, but I've added in a boards and committees program. This is something that I put into my budget, but it's something that could be utilized by the Board of Selectmen as well, so that every time somebody asks me, when was I elected to this board, I can actually go on to this system. The system will not only, it will tell who is up for reappointment, who's up for reelection. It will send letters to those people. It's just a very comprehensive program that better keep track of all the changes that happen. And that is for to purchase for this year is $2,290, and then it's got, in future years, it will have a $495 maintenance. So it's a pretty low yearly.
It's an upfront
fee. Yeah, it's just an upfront, and the good thing about I probably will ask a number of companies, but there's probably one that will be specific that does a lot of these type of things, and I've seen the program. They can adapt it to anything that we want. She creates the program for us, basically. Otherwise, the budget, the town clerk budget, is pretty much the same.
Say, are all the records archived now?
Excuse me. That is shut down. All the older ones are archived for town clerk stuff, and anything new is being saved that way, so I don't have to go back and archive later on. So that's pretty much taken care of. There's some other records that we may want to consider, some assessor's records that are permanent, some treasurer collector records that are permanent that I would in the future like to make sure that they're archived, but at this point in time, I'm not going that route. They're in pretty good shape. They aren't as in bad a shape as my town clerk records are. So that's it on the town clerk side of things.
Okay.
Town accountant is the next one. This just came in today, this afternoon. That's going to be up a little bit. That's $20,010.
Why the rise from 16 to 17, fiscal 16 to 17?
This is a...
I think we increased our hours.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Because we found that it's based on hours per week that someone works.
All right.
And we found that the hours weren't quite enough, so we increased the hours back.
Okay.
Harper's payroll, you want that one?
Yeah, I'll do Harper's payroll. I'm not really changing anything. It's the payroll, Harper's payroll is our payroll service. They do our W-2s, they do our Affordable Care Act reporting.
Mm-hmm.
So this budget's the same as it has been, or was last year, so.
Good.
Actually, it's $2 less.
Take it.
And the payroll preparation, if you have that in your packet, you can eliminate it. What happened was when we split the treasurer collector job into treasurer collector and assistant treasurer collector, I put the entire budget in the treasurer collector's budget, and that included this. So we don't even need this account. So, hey, I saved you $3,500.
Did you save it or did just...
Well, you saved it because I had it. It was duplicated last year.
Nice job
on both sides.
Accounting software.
Okay.
Again, that came with the FERCOG assessment. That's $750 again.
Okay.
So all of the machines, of course. And then I'll be quiet again.
Okay, back to treasurer collector.
Yes.
This budget really hasn't changed all that much. But I do have a note from the bottom, and this is something that both selectmen, I guess, and the personnel committee will have to meet. Due to the Affordable Care Act, there's a lot more reporting that we have to do from the payroll side of things. And Mary Ellen does most of the payroll. And what we were talking about is perhaps adding two additional hours to help her with the ACA reporting. I didn't include that in the budget yet because it needed to go through other sources first before it could be put in. But if I did that, it would add $2,132 to the budget. And that's basically the only thing I did add. I lowered some budget lines because I wasn't spending it all. And then I did add a shredding service, which can be utilized by
all town departments. It's like $35 a quarter, and I added a couple more pickups in between because we still do have a lot of cleaning out we have to do. So it's $250 for the year for shredding service.
Is the postage envelopes line item largely for sending out tax bills?
Yes.
And
tax bills, water bills.
Excise tax, water bills, any bill.
Any bill.
Right, so it strikes me that number should at some point be going down because these things should be electronic at some point. Yeah, is there a reason that it's not?
It's only good if the people can get electronic.
Well, yeah. The majority of people have electronic. Yeah,
it's only good if they
You get my point. I mean,
I do.
It's time to come into the 21st century.
Well, as you're paying, your book, there's a lot of people that don't want to. They want to.
Well, but that shouldn't be their issue. That should be their decision.
I can't foresee that I would be able to send these bills electronically. However, there are options available that I can put the database so that people could access it on our website. So that's a possibility. But that wouldn't prevent me from mailing them because I wouldn't know who's going to be accessing that.
Doesn't state law say that you have to?
And I have to mail. I believe it says that I have to mail them. Thank you, Paul. I forgot about that.
Yeah. State law mandates that we
mail.
That we stay
in the
trying to figure out how to invent fire.
Right. How many people pay their property tax by coming to the town offices versus electronically?
A lot.
There's a lot.
A lot.
Yeah.
More than half.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I think maybe 10% get paid online.
10%.
If that, I'm not even sure it's 10%.
Wow.
You either get it in the mail or they come here and hand it to
you. Maybe there should be some kind of an initiative to encourage people and to show people how easy it is.
Well,
when you get older and die,
you have two, you check.
You still got to mail it. I mean, she's still got to mail you the bill.
You got to mail it anyway.
Yeah, but you can mail electronically like you do your other bills from the bank. But the killer here is you've got a fee. And
there's a surcharge
here. And that's why a lot of people, like you say, for the $30 fee or whatever, we're going to drive down here and pay and put it in the box.
$30 fee.
Well, if you pay by credit card, it can be up to $100 and some odd.
Yeah, 20%
if you pay by credit. But if you pay by your bank account,
right.
People don't feel comfortable doing that. So it's 25 cents if you pay with your bank account. But if you pay with a credit card, it's based on what you're charging and how much.
Right. But I guess my point is, over time, that lack of comfort is going to change just as demographics change.
Oh, sure.
We probably won't see it, though.
Well, our generation is more comfortable than our parents' generation.
Oh, so we probably
actually, yeah. We're all comfortable with the rush.
I believe that the reason why I have to mail is tax bills have to be mailed 30 days prior to the due date.
Okay.
Then,
that's a state law.
Right. And then when I do the whole taking thing, I have to document that it was mailed to this date. So.
Right.
All right.
Wow.
Can you do payroll electronically? Or time cards, time sheets electronically, rather than people handing them in all the time?
They could if they wanted to. And buy the software program to do it. You don't cost money to do electronic time sheets. Either that or if they want to scan them into us, they can do that, but there's nothing safe there.
We could hire a clerk to scan it and then.
Sure.
Yeah, all right. They'll have to bring them anyway.
Okay.
Tax taking. This is kind of a hard one to anticipate how much I'm going to spend in any 1 year, but right now I do have tax attorney reviewing. I have two accounts that are being foreclosed on, and then there's a couple in bankruptcy. And she's monitoring those to make sure we don't miss any of the steps and making sure that we're in line to get some kind of money from those. And then there's a few accounts that have been kind of straggling for a while, and I am going to have to take action on those.
So this is for the process?
This is for the process. The attorney reviews tax titles and makes sure that everything is clear. clear and so that we can go the final step for tax takings.
If we win a legal battle on tax takings, do they have to pay our legal costs?
Yes.
So some of that, a lot of this comes
some
back.
Some of that comes back, yes.
Okay.
But it may take several years for that to go back. Mm-hmm. But I keep a running total on each account of what legal costs I've been spending on each one.
Getting to be more and more, or is it getting better?
Actually, I had a very long-term tax title paid off last week for $32,000.
That's nice.
You cruiser on
this. Hey, bite your tongue.
But I also
stabilization on those.
I also took four other accounts last year. Okay.
So we're not. Yeah. All right. It stays about the same.
Yeah.
All right. We've already done assessors.
Planning board.
Okay, planning.
They requested flat budget.
Well, yeah. So.
Can't complain about that. Zoning board.
Same
thing. Flat.
Finance committee.
Flat.
Big hit on the finance committee, right, Paul?
Hey.
Now 150.
Look at.
Way to go, Paul.
We're killing it. You guys should really buy yourself muffins for your meetings or something.
That's a 68% decrease.
We're using used books.
The what?
Recycled books.
That's a good example.
Recycled paper.
Moderator stays the same.
Conservation
stays the same.
Commission.
Historical stays the same.
Ag's the same.
Ag's the same.
This is the computer IT.
Okay.
So this is using the 3,000 from last year. And these are the other two items that came in here. They're noted here. There's also 1,200 from the Selectboard budget, the PC software backup, and the 1,000 from town building operations, computer repair IT. The town hasn't done a very good job of replacing its computers.
Does anybody?
Chips are they break a new one?
It does.
And that's what's happened this year, right? At least on one occasion, two occasions, right? The library one. Went out and the town account needed a new one because it wasn't compatible with trying to solve connection problems.
But things are backed up, so we're not losing stuff. Computers died.
Right? No, we're not losing stuff.
Because that's an expensive nut if you have to
lose stuff.
If you have to salvage stuff,
it would be expensive. Yes.
Connect.
CTY, that's. That's the robo.
They just called me about schools tomorrow.
Huh. Oh, really? Already?
That's not Lynn.
That's not me. That's the schools.
Yeah, no, right. It's still connect to CTY.
Yeah, but yeah. It's not.
Website and email homeschooling.
Yep. We can talk about this.
Okay.
Our current website hosting with a virtual town hall is. The contract we have now is $1,500. Talk about email hosting for a minute. Right now, the town has two internet accounts. One for the town hall and one for the center school. Those are completely unoccupied. But connected to each of those accounts are five emails that the town departments currently use. So we need to find a new email host, so find someone to do the email hosting for us to get rid of those
group,
those Comcast accounts.
So how's that going?
How's it going?
Somebody needs to do it.
Yeah, we need to do it.
You've been introduced to people who can do that, though.
Yes. We have a small grant, the Community Compact Program. We have $5,000 to do a detailed IT assessment with recommendations and specifications for growing up this job because of in terms of technology. And we have a pretty modern building, but each of our workstations are separate. We're not connected. There used to be a server here. Really? The library took it with them.
They took it?
Well, they took it with them and they cleaned it out. Story. Took it with them, cleaned it out, and they gave it back to us. And I had two different folks come back and two different IT firms come and look at it. As it's 8 years old, it's not worth it. the labor you're going to have to devote everything back on and get everybody connected.
Sure.
It's not worth it.
So who are the five departments connected in these places?
The five to each account. You're connected to Comcast, Highway, Police, Mary Ellen. Police has two.
Assessors, maybe.
Assessors is on Comcast.
Water.
So you're going to wait before the grant to see how this thing works, the IT consult, before you do anything?
That'll be part of your recommendation, so that we don't do something that's...
Yeah, that's just bizarre that those departments are like over there.
And then so we have that grant to do the detailed IT assessment in March. There's a mass IT grant that will pay for a lot of capital costs, but for municipalities to upgrade to future systems. So the idea is to get the detailed assessment, the specifications in time for the grant, to apply for the grant, so that a lot of the technology stuff will be paid for, at least the infrastructure parts of it will be paid for.
That's nice.
It all works out with that.
Housing committee?
Housing committee is flat. Municipal building committee is flat.
Insurance and benefits. Here we go. Here's the deal breaker.
You'll like it. If I'm reading it right, I'm liking it.
Who made this mistake?
Yeah. That's not right.
Okay, there's two different pages for the group insurance. There's a detailed page on the second page. Come to find out what's been happening is that over the last couple of years, the entire amount of our insurance has been budgeted. And really, we really only need the budget pound share. So that's why it's gone down. Considering that insurance actually went up 9.4% this year, that's a pretty good sign, because we are actually lowering that budget.
Now, Lynn, the flip side of that is going to be, if we were over budgeting, it means that was helping our free cash at the end of the year.
It was.
So
yes.
Our free cash is going to take a hit at the end of the year.
So, but this budget, I also added two additional family plans. I've always done that over the years, just because it'll cover any of the changes that come into place during the year. We just found out there's going to be hiring that full-time temporary substitute at the school, but she will be eligible for insurance. So there goes I don't know if it's going to be a family plan or whether she's even going to want insurance, but it's those type of situations that I like to have a little buffer in there for to cover, so I don't have to come back to you. And then if we don't use it, it rolls into the free cash. So.
An open enrollment for existing employees is May, correct?
It's May, yes.
So that happens after our town meeting, which...
Right. So you've got to have that kind of figured in, too. Okay. Somebody may want to change.
Okay. Plus, you know, they have... The school doesn't predict any retirements for the coming year, because I called them and said, but you never know. We did have one this last year, mid-year, that we didn't know about. So then you're covering a retiree and the new replacement. So those are the kinds of things we really have to kind of figure in there somewhere.
So unless your hands are tied.
Yep.
And so the retiree insurance, the Medex rather, that increases, or I don't want to say increases, because you never know, perhaps it might not. But that is from January on. The other insurances are on a fiscal year. So that's all on the health insurance. Anybody have any questions?
Last year, that was a big bugaboo for the personnel committee. It was a giant increase in health insurance. We're going to see that again as a hit to the...
Well, 9.4% is already figured into this budget.
Yeah.
The 9.4% increase for this coming year. So it still went down because we're only budgeting the town share.
but in reality...
In reality, the...
It went up
9.4%.
So, looking at it from my point of view, is the town is picking up another 9-point-something percent of an employee's...
You're picking up 75% of 9.4%.
So we're, you know, they say they're not getting a raise or whatever, they're getting, they're more of their health insurance went up, and, I mean, yeah, it's gonna cost them, but we're paying for it, the town's paying for it too.
But we're still, correct me if I'm wrong, we're still the highest match in the Frontier District.
Yes.
Yes.
Because we pay 75%.
Because we pay, and some towns pay, I think it's over 60, or maybe 50 even.
Sunderland is 50, but they're running into problems, or they may be running into problems with some of their employees with the Affordable Care Act.
Right.
Because they aren't, it's not affordable to the employees, so they may end up having to raise theirs. I think South Deerfield is 70%. Conway's 70, and Sunderland's 50.
50?
Oh, no, Deerfield's 65.
Do they do something on the salary side that's different?
You know, I haven't noticed that their salaries are all that much higher. They're
It depends. I mean, you're not...
It's a bigger town.
Yeah, it's
a bigger town.
You're not comparing, you can't compare Whately Highway Department to the South Deerfield Highway Department. South Deerfield's 2.5 times bigger than the Whately Highway Department, because there's more roads, there's more this, there's more that. So you can't compare the two. You gotta compare Whately to...
Conway.
Yeah, not even Conway.
Conway's got a lot more roads.
Conway's got a lot more roads.
A lot more roads, same population, but more roads.
Yeah.
State personnel.
The next budget is Medicare and Social Security, and year after year, we come to you and ask you at the end of the year for a reserve fund transfer because we miscalculated it. And I finally figured out why it was being miscalculated, and that's because in the school budget, the grants don't show up in there, so anyone with a grant-funded position, their salary wasn't included, so when you took the 1.65% and multiplied it times the entire payroll, you were missing that out of the section of payroll.
You got to pay
it. So now I've increased that. Hopefully it will absorb that amount for the...
So you're confident that 30,000
that should cover it, yeah.
Sure. Life insurance.
And life insurance, again, we were budgeting the entire share. The town employee pays 50% of the life insurance, so that one went down.
Well, I think the time of retirement went up.
Yeah.
That's out of our hands.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Very frustrating.
Yep. And that amount for Franklin County retirement is to be paid on July 1st. Pay the entire amount. You get a little bit of a discount.
Wow. Have we had conversations with these people recently about how unsustainable those increases are?
Well, those increases are working much like the OPEB account. They're making up for future liability.
Oh, okay.
So that's why that...
That's why that's... Okay. Yeah. My hands are tied, sort of, too.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
How are we doing?
What else?
Any questions for Lynn or Brian or Mary Ellen or anybody else?
I'm not sure how the employees couldn't afford the insurance in Sunderland, how the Affordable Care Act plays into that.
It's a certain percentage, and how the town is even going to know this, but if an employee brings it up, some of the people who are working, you know, a 25-hour week, but they're benefited for insurance, and their household income is less than, I can't remember what the dollar amount is, then it's considered that it's not affordable.
And they should be lying on the exchange.
And then in Sunderland has to pay a penalty.
They should be lying on the exchange then.
Yeah.
The town should be offered it to them.
But we have to.
They can give up, they can pay it on the exchange. They don't have to, they can drop their hours down.
But the town has to offer it. If they choose not to...
Well, the town's offering it at 24 hours. They don't have to do that.
Yes, we do. You have to. If they've accepted Chapter 32B of Mass General Law, which most towns did back many, many years ago, you have to offer insurance after 20 hours.
To drop the hours below that.
Well, that's my town clerk job.
That's a discussion for another.
That's a heated conversation.
Yeah, that's...
Well, and the person who wants to work 22 hours doesn't get the benefit, you bump them up to 40, turn it into a full-time job and work every day.
Yeah, it's a huge benefit.
The salary side.
Yeah.
But back when...
Operate the ground.
Back when the law was passed, it wasn't even a concern because insurance back then was just not anything that people really worried about. But now with the cost of insurance...
Because we all want to live for it.
Yeah. And the other thing that I am going to push this year is we have the Hampshire County Insurance Trust has a program through Canada for certain, not generic, you know, I can't think of the word. What's the word? Brand name.
Brand name drugs.
Brand name drugs.
Yeah.
You can buy them through this Canada RX program, and it doesn't cost the employee anything. You don't even have to pay a copay. But because the costs are so much cheaper for the Hampshire Insurance Trust to go through Canada, that it benefits them.
The caveat is it only works if you have a drug on that list.
Right.
If you don't have a drug on that list, then it doesn't do any good.
Well, there are a lot of really common drugs, but there are a lot of common drugs that aren't on that list either.
Yeah.
They do keep updating the list constantly, but I know I'm on two different prescriptions that I don't have to pay anything for because
it's like hugely a quarter of the cost of what they cost here.
Yeah, but I'm going to make sure that I get that advertised to people because that will help the Hampshire Insurance Trust keep their premiums down.
Get the word out.
So.
Do we have any further questions or anybody on any topic? Brian, do you have a wrap up?
I have a scheduling note for you guys.
Okay.
The school is planning on coming to the March 8th meeting.
Okay.
That was those 3 days I'm on the schedule there.
Yep.
Then conflicts for the first one. Some folks are on vacation for the second one.
So March
vacation. So
at 6 o'clock?
Yeah.
I will not be here.
I will not be. What's the 8th on Wednesday?
Yeah.
Should be good. Tell me, you're going to be here? You're going to go... Are you leaving yet?
No, I'm not leaving yet.
Okay. And who won't be here?
I won't be here.
You guys will be here. You going to be here?
I'm not.
Okay. Alrighty. That's good. Any last thoughts? Just, look, the big nut is this town hall. And,
well, the town hall is, but you've got to talk about merging the water. And I don't think the water's going to be free.
No, it won't be free.
I think this town hall thing is going to, I'm hoping, is going to finance itself.
Yeah, I hope so.
That's the plan.
It looks like it will.
It looks like it will.
Only if we get a grant.
Even if it doesn't.
Even if it doesn't, you're paying out of future revenue.
Right.
CPC. You're paying out of future revenues.
Right. The backup.
Yeah.
The number, if there's anything that, and I don't have an answer to this, but if there's anything more that we could do over and above what we're doing to try to, I hate to use the word sell this project, but
to get it through this.
This
time
is the sweetest
deal
we've ever had for this building. And we've dropped a lot of cash on this building without getting, dime one back for it. And this is the time, and we can't afford to have...
It's got to go this time, or it's done.
Paul, you know what? To answer your question, I would start by a little bit of re-messaging of what you just said.
we have spent a lot of money on this project, but it has been a critically important iterative process. There's no way this was going to happen at the snap of the fingers. The money that's been spent has been a necessary iterative process to get us to where we are today.
Correct.
So the investment has been made, and now is the time to see the return on the investment. It has not been a waste of money.
Exactly. Right. And the thing we want to avoid is, I think if we go back in time, we go back 15 years and we look at those other processes to try to get this town hall going, I think we had individuals that automatically voted no matter what. And we wouldn't want to see that happen again this time, that there'd be an automatic no vote. I voted for it twice. I voted it down twice, you know? We want to see if we can avoid that. And talk as positively as we can about it.
I think the key point that keeps having to be made is that as the financing structure, there will be no impact on the tax rate.
That's right.
The cost is going down considerably.
Yeah. But I think as far as people understanding it, that your taxes will not go up a penny if this project gets approved.
And it won't impact the town's ability to do anything in the future.
Right. And it may have economic benefits.
In 75 years or whatever you need for the grant.
And we all feel very comfortable about that 315. Because, come on, it was windfall money.
Yeah.
I mean, that did not come from the tax rolls, and that's not going to happen again.
Right.
Anytime soon.
I'd like to see that whole amount up again. It's really big right now. Because our budget, our costs went up to the 1.2. So.
I know, Fred. And you guys got to try to.
Sharpen your pencil, Fred.
You guys got to try to.
You know, windfall money is also a project that's really. We can't afford to delay any further.
It won't happen if we do.
No, it will not happen, no.
And the building will just fall down.
Yeah. And that'll be a disaster.
There you go. Motion to adjourn?
I make a motion.
All in favor? Have a good week.